Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Steve Marshall. I am Attorney General of Alabama and one of the co-chairs of the task force. I greatly appreciate everybody's attendance today. I'm really excited about the opportunity that we've been given by Governor Ivey to make a dramatic impact on this state and its home state collectively, the people around this table and others that are working on the Alabama task force for us to have an impact on what is truly a significant issue for us in the state. Let me do a couple of housekeeping things to begin with. First of all, you see that we've got a fairly packed agenda. We'll take a break probably roughly an hour into the meeting, and we'll come back and finish the rest of our agenda for this afternoon. The bathrooms are, if you go out that back hallway, they'll be right there on the left and the right. Unless we have water on the table, if you need some more water, let us know. We'll be glad to try to get that for you. One of the things along my co-chairs that we did was go ahead and set up two additional meetings of this task force before our report is going to be similar. We're going to give you those dates now and the times for those meetings. The next date for this task force will be October 24th at 1 o'clock. And right now, unless something changes, we'll again shoot to have it in our office here. The next meeting will be December 5th at 1 o'clock, likewise here. We expect that December 5th meeting that will be the time for us to be able to address and vote on specific recommendations that will go as part of our strategic plan. But also, I think it is our belief going forward that we'll have a mission all past that December 31st date because there will be much to do and much to evaluate going forward. Everybody should have in front of them some handouts. Let me tell you a little bit about kind of what you got there and why you got them. First of which is obviously our agenda for today, along with a listing of individuals on the task force, as well as other members that have previously been working on various committees that we'll talk about in a minute. We'll also have, you can see, contact information for those of you that have been appointed by the member of the task force, as well as the specific entities that are represented by the folks that are listed. The second thing that you'll see underneath is a memo that was prepared by our office, which basically I asked them to do a survey of what other states were working on in this area and to see whether or not there seemed to be some consensus of areas that folks have worked on. This is not intended for you to be able to look at is to say these are things that we ought to adopt, as much as specify our committees that are working with these are issues that other states have identified as potential areas of emphasis, and wanted you to be aware at least of what appears to be some consensus around the country about recommendations coming from similar task forces. We also provided you with a copy of what George did recently relating to a study commission that was through their Senate. Underneath that is a report by a group called SARA, the Board of Prevention Project, which really outlines much of what came from their recommendations, and again, when we looked around the country, it was one of the best reports that we saw. Finally, is just so that you know that obviously we're not alone in Alabama, is a report that came out of Government Magazine just a couple of days ago related to Wilmington, North Carolina, and efforts very similar to what we are taking on here. So those are there for your review and going forward, maybe have some help in the issues that we're dealing with now. The only thing I thought would be helpful is to again remind us specifically of why we're here. Governor Ivey and I met at length a few months ago to talk about the need for us to be able to continue to do work and develop a strategic plan going forward to deal with this area. Y'all are aware that although I outranked my co-chairs in longevity by much time, 7 months for me in AG is not much, but I've been around the state, and one thing that I have raised in the various meetings that I've attended is, tell me what it is that you expect us to be working on, or what do you see in your communities? And it has been universal in the various meetings I've had, whether it be a breakfast with a group in Baldwin County, to sitting with law enforcement down in Wiregrass, to sitting around with folks who are part of the chamber up in North Alabama, is there was some perspective dealing with the issue of opioids here and fentanyl was safe. from a physical therapist telling me that they can't provide therapy to many patients because they are not safely able to do it because they are under the influence of some type of pain medication. To law enforcement, who is prescribing their role basically as a mental health provider in the state because of issues that they are dealing with. To hear from businesses talking about getting employees back from workers' comp issue. It seems to be taking longer now that they have in the past, and part of that is a result of what's going on here. I've heard from multiple people from a variety of areas, not just in the nature of the overdoses we're seeing in deaths, but really how it is impacting all aspects of our society. It's one of the reasons why when we look around this room, everybody here has some role and function in us, either having to address this issue and what we do, but also understanding how it is that we come up with efforts to try to deal with the crisis that we face. And so when Governor Ivey appointed this task force to continue, I thought that that was an important decision for the state. And here's what she's asked us to do. To advise and assist her in the development of a comprehensive coordinated strategy to combat Alabama's opioid crisis, gather and review data characterizing the opioid crisis facing Alabama, including the threat of synthetic opioids, review strategies and actions already taken in Alabama to combat the opioid crisis, review strategies and actions of other states, the National Government Association of Compact on Opioid Addiction, and develop a comprehensive strategic plan to abate the opioid crisis in Alabama. And we got to do all that by December 31st. And I know that we're up to that task. One thing that we have the opportunity to draw upon, and one thing that we will do today, is the fact that in a previous task force, there were committees in which many of you were active and had the opportunity to be able to begin work and develop some recommendations. And so we'll have a report of that today. But also, those of you that are new to this task force, we'll want to make sure that you specifically are able to work on those committees going forward, so it's very important that we had. So by the time we get to this meeting in December, we really will have coalesced around a consensus of recommendations for us to eventually put in a strategic plan. The other thing that you will see from the co-chairs is that we will each take ownership of a couple of committees. Commissioner Bashir made a rule 3, and she's going to talk about one of the new ones we may want to add to that list today. And so we will make outreach to our committee chairs so that you'll know specifically where we're working in those areas that we have specific involvement. Thank you for that work that you've already done, and we'll continue to work with you for each of the co-chairs to make sure that we're making progress and continue to make a difference. I obviously come at this total with the law enforcement perspective. One thing that is of significant concern to me is what law enforcement is having to do daily and dealing with those that are suffering from this addiction, those who are unable to successfully get into treatment programs or are looking for alternatives to their current situation. More importantly, one of the things that I'm seeing is this has become an officer safety issue in this state, where we have law enforcement officers without access to naloxone that are coming into contact with fentanyl. I was talking to one of my sheriffs recently about one of their deputies who just simply was engaging in inventory search of a vehicle to touch something he didn't know what it was, and began to have tingling hands and began to feel some change in his body. Fortunately, that sheriff was proactive and obtained naloxone products, so to make sure the officer was safe. One of the issues that you'll hear me talk about is the law enforcement side of what is it we can do to make sure that we're ensuring that safety. One of the things that we've done, just so that you know, and I think it is important for us, separate and apart from this task force, is to be able to work to make sure that naloxone is available statewide and in a way that law enforcement has access, but also it's affordable. And one of the people that we talked to early on was AF Pharma, who has developed a product that is no spray for law enforcement to be able to use, a very effective way to be able to administer it. And also that AF Pharma has agreed to set a price for us, much lower than what is otherwise available. AF Pharma is here and present today. Constantly is here. Grateful for him being here and grateful that we've been able to already allow law enforcement to know that that is something that they have access to. And appreciate you setting that price for them for the rest of the year, and appreciate the fact that we recognize that not only is this an issue for those who suffer addiction, but also it's become an officer safety issue. We've got to make sure that we can protect officer safety in the state. So having said that, I guess I will simply close with this. I'm not sure that there is a more important project that we can be working on in Alabama right now than the one that we've been given. We see this impacting communities in ways that maybe we never imagined. We've seen this nationally and know that this is not something that's unique to Alabama. Yet what I hope is that we can, in some ways, although we represent specific groups here, is that we take away a little bit of those group affiliations and understand that we have an obligation to do what's best for people in Sierra Leone. Going forward, is to develop consensus with that being our focus on how we get outside of our unique silos here, that whether it's the public health side, the mental health side, community engagement, or law enforcement, that we understand that each of us play an important role, and without the other, there's no way for us to ultimately be successful as a year. So having said that, I'm going to turn over to my two co-chairs to give any additional opening statements that they'd like, and then we'll get this meeting started.
Good afternoon, and I'd like to say welcome and thank you so much for being here this afternoon. If there haven't been any, since I've only been in my position now for about 7 weeks, if the people who have been involved in this work previously, if you would just raise your hand, if you were on the previous. Okay, great. And if you're brand new today to this front on the council, please raise your hand. All right, thank you. Well, we're going to depend heavily on our experienced veterans here as we move forward to try to meet this deadline. I don't know how many of you were at my swearing-in on July the 10th, but at that time, and I know you can't see this, but this is a photograph of the word hope. And what this is a car bumper somewhere in downtown Montgomery. It's all beat up, and it's kind of surrounded by leaves and cigarette butts and other debris. But this has been in my office for 17 years in the vision process. I was executive director of Envision 2020, which is a regional vision process. And I saw Envision as hope in the midst of sort of a mess. And I decided I would take this picture with me because I see this council as the same sort of thing. This is hope in the midst of one of the biggest messes this country's ever been in. And it is going to require the brain power and commitment and time of every person in this room, and probably every person with whom you come in touch. I want to make sure that you all know who Diane Boyer is. She's sitting right here. Diane, raise your hand. Okay, Diane is in charge of the substance abuse side of the house at the Department of Mental Health. And so she is really more than expert on this than I am. I'm learning every day. I'm drinking from the fire hose. But Diane has been involved in this work from the beginning. And so you're going to see me rely a lot on her. And she's going to be a go-to person for us. I think a couple things that I would like to suggest that we keep in mind as we move through this work is, first of all, the only behavior that you can change is your own. Okay, so we want other people to behave in a different way, either to do something or not to do something. We have to decide what we're going to do differently. So that's what we're all about today, is to figure out how we need to do differently on the healthcare side of the house, on the legal side of the house, on the social service side of the house, to eradicate, if possible, to certainly decrease this problem of opioid and substance abuse. And all healthcare is local, right? At the end of the day, the most important thing about healthcare is between you and your doctor. So for that reason, we are going to have this new committee. To the six committees, we're going to have a seventh committee, and we're calling it community engagement. And that's going to come up under my responsibility. Dr. Harris is going to take the prescriber dispenser committee and the rescue committee, and A.G. Marshall, Steve Marshall, Attorney General Marshall, is going to take the data committee and the law enforcement. And then I'm going to be working on the treatment and recovery the prevention and education, and the community engagement. So we will be your liaisons as your committees are working. And we're going to need to identify a chair and a co-chair of the community engagement committee. So if you are interested in that, please speak to me. let's see. And then the third point I want to make is that substance use disorder is a disease in the brain. It's scary to us. We don't react to the way we react to other diagnoses. If a friend or family member has cancer or heart disease or any other problems, we react with sympathy. If someone is addicted to drugs, whether through their own fault or that of a prescriber, a trusted prescriber, then we tend to think of them in a whole different way. So I would invite us to try to think of this as a disease of the brain. I think it'll help us as we try to take the emotion and prejudice out of what we do and put it in a realm of science and sociology and all of the other sciences that need to come around figuring out solutions. It is not a character flaw. That's all I want to say at this point. I appreciate the opportunity to work with you, and particularly with my co-chairs. I'm very excited that Dr. Scott Harris, who is now 5 days on the job, I'm going to invite him to come to the microphone. We are so fortunate to have a person of Dr. Harris's ability, his personality, to be working with us on this. We'll be very excited that he's heading up your Alabama Department of Public Health. Dr. Harris.
Thank you, Commissioner, very much. It's really only 3 working days, so kind of invite that. thank you, Attorney General, for hosting us and having us here today. I'm just going to be real brief going third. People have already said most of the things to be said, but I really don't know a more important issue that faces our state. And we need all of you here. We're glad you're here. We really want to cooperate with you and work with you. I'm all about collaboration and cooperation. We all bring different strengths. We all bring different ideas. And together, we can make a difference in this. And we really want to do that. My background is actually in HIV. I went to medical school, about 30 years ago. And in those days, that was such a horrible problem, and still is. But, we had nothing to do with patients simply in those days. And yet, now we realize that this opioid epidemic, the overdose, the numbers of overdoses we're seeing are outpacing the deaths we saw from HIV back in that day. And it's just hard to even imagine that it could be on that scale. This is the biggest public health problem that we're facing at this time in this country. We're really glad you're here because we need your help. We want to work together. Please bring your ideas and your energy. And thanks again for being here.
Well, there's a lot of gifted people around this table. What I'd like to be able to do initially is let's go around the room. If you notice, there are microphones that are on the table for recording this, so if you might give them a few today, we have the ability to be able to take that and give them, for them to be able to listen later. But if you would, introduce yourself, talk a little bit about maybe your perspective or your role or some impact that this issue has on you. And so let's just put a walk around the table so that everybody knows who's here, and maybe a little bit about kind of your history with it. Ryan, let's start with your front end.
My name is Brian Warren. I work with the Alabama Farmers Federation, and from our perspective, I would say the 2 key issues that are important to us would be as a judgment on rural health care, but also the impacts that it has on rural crime for rural people and farmers.
David Alcorn with the University of Alabama, and we are partnered with NIH to integrate behavioral health care settings in West Alabama and Blackville. So I would say the integration of behavioral health care
Thank you. I'm Susan Alverson. I'm director of the Board of Pharmacy. And our challenge, I think, is on one hand to do our part to control the amount of opioids that end up on the street or end up or that end up with wrong patients. And on the other side, to get pharmacists to remember that they're dealing with patients, and you can't always treat these people as criminals and vice versa.
I'm Bill Baggins. I'm the division chief of law enforcement, public safety division for DACA. I'm involved in this for a public resource for drug treatment and education.
I'm Representative Lane, who serves in the southwest corner of Alabama, four counties in rural Alabama. I'm also a semi-retired pharmacist. And I still serve about 17, 18 years ago. My husband was also a pharmacist and we were filling prescriptions. He had a pain for it. And he looked at me and he said, there's going to be a problem with this one day. Well, he didn't even live to see that problem with prescription drugs, but I did. And the state representative, I want to see that we work something that will help our people. Keep them out of being incarcerated, get them in treatment centers to address this problem, and so that's my full support here on out.
I'm Erica Butler, representing the Department of Education, provision support services, and we are trying to get the number of students who are on teachers of the community.
Good afternoon. I'm Paul Butler, Deputy Commissioner for the Peer Administration for the Department of Human Resources, Division of Mexico. We see this problem of a very prevalent in how we're working with our families, and especially with the infant children across the state and how that impacts their lives. So we're very glad to participate in this today.
I'm Paul Cook. I'm with the Department of Psychiatry and UAD. And I am sitting from Mark Wilson. I serve the bill on the Pills and Needles Collaborative that we have in Jefferson County, which is expanding access to naloxone that's pulling together various resources we have in the collaborative effort to let treatment access more available and have the gear.
Good afternoon, I'm Jeff Dunn, Alabama Department of Corrections. Our interest here is, unfortunately, many of our incarcerated individuals in the state of Alabama come to us with addiction issues, and unfortunately, because of the state of our prison system, we struggle to keep contraband drugs out of our system. And so we have a very vested interest in doing what we can to slow down the addiction of that prison system.
Good afternoon, I'm Robert Britt. I'm the commissioner. And I manage the consumer complaint office at the Alabama Trust Department.
I'm Norris Green. I'm the executive director of the Board of Medical Examiners. I'm standing in today for Dr. Thor Bowman, who's visiting here today to go to the next meeting. I've got the board members here to talk to you a little bit about what our board is doing, but I will say we've been very active in addressing the physician complaints against the physician who have some prescribed.
Matt Hart with the Board of Medical Examiners, Director. Here, our perspective is we want to see what we can do from a prescriber standpoint, what role we can play to help curb addiction from the beginning, from a prescriber perspective. Additionally, previously worked with the state prosecutor personally, so I'd like for all that experience as well to be involved in this.
We're in the council with the administrative office of courts. We administer the court referral programs and drug court programs for alcohol substance abuse.
I'm David Herrick. I'm a physician. I'm representing the Medical Association and our ongoing interest and concerns in trying to help solve this problem.
Hello, I am Susan
Sassel.
I'm the president of the Alabama. And that is essentially all the other prisons in the state of Alabama. We also do
Stanley is a new pilot with us, and so, for the hourly fee on one lesson, we are the most regulated medical facility in the United States. And people, you know, they think it's the hospitals and all that, but truly, we are the most regulated, and that's published in the White House.
I'm Josh Johnson, my day job, I'm chief urologist at WSMA-TV here in Montgomery. If you want to talk about Hurricane Irma, so you can. I remember Brother Chris got the hero of this in October 2015, so, it's now kind of my life's great work to talk to young people. I talk to thousands of young people over here about drugs, and what's interesting is everybody talks to any small, I ask them, raise your hand if you're going to talk to you about drugs. Every hand is up. Keep your hands up to talk to you about alcohol. Most hands stay up. Cocaine, most hands stay up. Prescription pain pills, I don't usually hands stay up. So we have a huge workload in front of us to educate and hopefully we can accomplish that.
Louise Jones, I'm executive director of the Alabama Pharmacy Association.
Good afternoon. My name is Mark Woodline, and I'm the Director of Marketing and Community Outreach for ROSS, the Recovery Organization of Support Specialists. We are a peer-run recovery organization here in Birmingham, Alabama. I'm also a certified recovery support specialist, certified by the Alabama Department of Mental Health, and I'm a person in long-term recovery, and that means I haven't had a drink or a drug since March 1st, 2013. And just being on the front lines of things, I want to see more help for those with access to treatment, and especially those that don't have money or insurance.
Thank you. Mary Hatson, Executive Director now for the AIDS Association and State Office of Prosecution Services. My role here is Chairman of the Alabama Youth Task Force. That's a group of no budget group of folks that come together regularly to really bring folks together that can do relationships and grow prevention opportunities across the state. And one thing that I think to me is important, I'm very good at two things, is being a pretty positive one of the 6 years, sorry about 14, is that most addiction, most issues we deal with are poly drug issues. I've like heard you say this before. We fell in Alabama, we fell with citizens with the crisis in the 80s and 90s. We did the same thing as meth, and here we are with opiates. In 10 years, we'll get another drug. By now, I'll also serve on the Southeast Ohio Task Force and Prevention SWAT, and I have this report a year to be about the legislation. And what do you think the number one drug in Alabama is? Meth. The only drug for treatment and use in the force is meth in Alabama. Hair is moving up, opioids are moving up, and you're able to take it next year. So I think this is an incredible opportunity for people with power, authority, passion, drive, and commitment to really once and for all attack that what I think is the number one threat to this state, not ISIS, situation. It is cheaper for China to ship heroin into America and smuggle into Mexico. We can make it back into this country through a normal smuggling warehouse. Meth is not made in Alabama, that's not homegrown meth anymore. They for personal use is coming across from zero labs as ICE. They come together. With all the drugs, they come together. The same house, the same folks. There's an enforcement component, prevention component, education, treatment, and removal of the stigma, as you said, that condition and so anyway, I think it's an opportunity to look at this. You know, when you see the overdose deaths, you see it's not just going to go up, and usually they start off with heroin. So this is just a bigger issue. So I hope it's happening.
I am Jim McLennan, a retired optometrist, but I'm also a member of the Alabama Senate, and I am chairman of the Health and Human Services in the Senate. I also serve, or am serving, I'm not sure which, as chairman of Prescriber Dispensary Practices Subcommittee. I'm not sure. I didn't catch how that's going to work, but I did. We have a start to
Jimmy Weeby. I'm the SBI Director of Oralea, and of course we have the social side of the narcotics. But also we bring to the table with a few percent numbers of stats that we bring to this division. And the numbers are astounding, as I'm listening to you know. I also sit on the House Executive Chair for Southeast United States. And, we've been looking at this for a long time. This is a problem that's growing and growing, and I'm excited to have everybody here and work on this issue because it's something really needs to be addressed.
I'm Brian Day. I'm the president of the VA Association. In 24 years of practicing law, I've started out with crack cocaine in the Los Angeles, Maryland City, and methamphetamine in the Los Angeles, Maryland City, and synthetic drugs in Maryland City. The difference is we run about 85-90% of our crime is all things we have all the drugs, all drug-related. So our crime to go down, the drugs are going to have to be the difference in opioids and fentanyl and carfentanyl and heroin is within overdose deaths and overdose is an opioid that is a long-term physical ailment syndrome. And if you don't do something about it now,
I'm Robert Williams, Chief Medical Officer of the Department of Health and Human Services, and also Deputy Commissioner of Health and Systems. Three different things I would say. First, we're very concerned about health, that all recipients and health is as much broader term than health care. And that's one of the reasons I'm really glad to be part of this group, because it does require a multidisciplinary approach to the U.S. distribution. Obviously, Medicaid, we're concerned about cost, and cost is significant. When you look at individuals in our system, they haven't got an excess of substance use disorder, they're anywhere from 100% to 300% increased cost for us, so that's a concern. And then finally, when you talk about our Medicaid, you're primarily talking about women who have babies and children. And we actually see a fairly large number of them growing, and we will have some syndrome and children with bowling and diverse effects on Medicaid and other children are more expensive and more expensive for us. So, very glad to be part of this group and we're going to work today.
My name is Mel Warren, and I'm the Assistant Executive Director of Board of Quality and Growth. From our perspective, our interest in this council is the development and implementation of strategies to kind of provide more access to treatment for not only the people that we supervise, but everyone else in the state who has an addiction that needs services. And we have a kind of twofold interest, but we're also interested in strategies that allow our officers to have more access to substances like Naloxone for their work in the field and this clientele.
Thank you.
I am the director of the regional Boys and Girls Center of Children's of Alabama. We have been doing this surveillance for the last 10 years on controlled substances. We've been sharing our data with the DEA just on opioids the last 2 years. We share our data with the synthetic cannabinoids and turn that over to the Alabama Department of Public Health, and we're helpful as far as getting that scheduled one. We also surveil cathinones, the bath salts, and we, of course, are available to physicians and parents when there is an opioid ingestion. We've seen a real big increase since 2010 when all the pharmaceutical deterrents came about with heroin. We have seen a big drop in the last couple of years in our hydrocodone calls, so we're constantly watching. We're still getting about 3,000 calls on opioids a month.
Good afternoon. I'm Zach Stutz, former executive director of the Alabama Dental Association. In a former life, I practiced in general dentistry for 4 years in Montgomery, and probably one of the two people in the room who could legally write prescriptions for opioids. I saw that of the standpoint of patients who were addicted to trying to get medication for me. I'm a regular basis with the there. I have my office program in to at least do that for people trying to get opioids out of our drugs, drug inventory. And then in another life, again, I decided I wanted to go back to graduate school and got a degree in counseling, a master's degree in counseling. And at the end of my graduate program, my internship was with a substance abuse center. So I spent 6 months doing group counseling at old St. Margaret's drug center. That opened my eyes even back then, well before the opioid epidemic came out. I think we're going on in drug culture and I'm learning the state of the nation. So this is near and dear to my heart.
Hello, my name is Bobby Jotan. And I am a certified recovery support specialist certified by the Department of Mental Health. I also work at Family Drug Court, also known as Family Wellness Court, which is changed our name, with UAB. What I would like to see the most out of this whole thing is more places to allow people to go and get treatment. And more wraparound services. So they come in and they're wanting help and super excited and make a couple of free phone calls because there's not a lot of places for people to go. And they have to wait for a few weeks if they're wanting to detox and if they're wanting to go to patients. So I'd really love to see just more facilities to help people get equipment. They want to do it.
Good afternoon. My name is Stephen Taylor. I'm an addiction psychiatrist and a child and adolescent psychiatrist, and I'm here as a member of the Alabama Society of Addiction Medicine, which is the Alabama chapter of the American Society of Addiction Medicine, which is a professional organization of physicians who specialize in the treatment of patients with addiction disorders. I'm here actually sitting in for Dr. Brandon Boyette, who is the dentist and family practice physician, who is the president of the Alabama Society of Addiction Medicine. Our role as addiction specialists is multifaceted. One, of course, is the direct treatment of patients with addiction disorders. Also, we are involved in trying to grow the field, the supply of trained addiction specialist physicians so that we can address the very problem that you mentioned and some other folks have mentioned, where there's just not being enough treatment available to people who have these disorders and need specialized treatment. And then, of course, we support many of us, and myself included, spend a great deal of time in the community educating various groups in the community about the disease of addiction. Whether it's working with parents at schools, educating them about how to prevent substance use among their children and teenagers, educating a variety colleagues and other professionals about this disease, and in fact, educating our colleagues in the medical profession about how to properly treat their patients who have substance use disorders. So obviously our interest here is very important, and I'm very thrilled to be here, even though I'm just sitting here to be a part of this commission.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Darlene Travis-Stan, an internal medicine physician at Birmingham area, and for the Alabama Board of Medical Examiners. And although I don't appreciate a lot of opioids in my practice, and our patient population doesn't require those, my interest in this work came through chairing the Quality of Care Committee for the Alabama Healthcare Improvement Task Force. And there were some significant players on that task force that led us down the path of making the opioid crisis one of our major initiatives that we've been working on. And that culminated in the Alabama Opioid Summit, which happened here at Prattville in March of this year. And what through a lot of hard work and planning that summit, many of the people in this room and what I grew to appreciate is how much passion there is here and how much talent there is here. And if we can simply get past our turf, our budgets, and do what's best for people to stand up on all that we can see here. So I'm so encouraged to see you all be here today and excited to be able to work with you. Good afternoon, I'm April Weavers, and I'm representative chairman of the House Health Committee. I'm currently the only nurse serving in the Alabama legislature. I've spent about the past 20 years in hospital administration. I've been a House sponsor of many of the prescription drug use bills during the 7 years that I've been in the legislature, and most, if not all, of these bills do come through the health care in the House. And I'm very proud to be a part of this group and have my full support for this issue.
Hi, I'm Anne Schmidt. I'm the director at the Cross Blue Shield of Alabama, and we're very happy to be a part of this group. We see the impact of opioid misuse and abuse on our members and also on the families of those members, and we also see the impact in healthcare costs, not only for individuals and facilities, which I think is what comes to mind first when we hear about that cost, but we also see the cost in the business community, some of those groups that we underwrite and also those businesses that fund their own healthcare. So we're really happy to be at the table as we look for a solution for this crisis.
My name is David White. I'm going to be a senior policy advisor to the plan, not a council member. I'm here to listen to them.
I am Jamie Gerber, Alabama Department of Public Health, and I'm not a council member. I'm the silent partner for Dr. Harris to help him address this epidemic we're going through right now as best we can.
I'm Clay Crenshaw, Chief Deputy AG.
I'm Diane Boyer, and I am a not so silent partner for the commissioner this year. But there isn't a week that goes by that I don't get an email just to our website asking for help. Sometimes it's multiple emails every week. And this group of people can help us move forward in seeing that these people get help. And even the ones that aren't asking for it, that we can reach out, find them, and get them into treatment.
Right. Again, thank you for your willingness to be here and be part of this. There's a lot to do, but I have no doubt that we'll be able to make the efforts that come around. We'll have an opportunity, and our legislative members that are here, to be able to make a difference in this going forward. I think it is, I described earlier what Governor Abbott defined as a purpose. I think what she's looking for from this body by December 31st is a measurable way of developing a strategic plan so that we have the ability not only to develop strategies, but also to be able to look down the road to see the impact, either positive or negative, of the recommendations that come from this body. And I think it's worth, again, reminding everyone of what she's asked us to do. Is to develop the strategic plan that does several things. One, improve surveillance of opioid misuse, addiction, and overdose. Two, to expand access to appropriate prevention, treatment, and recovery support services for opioid disorders. Three, to improve access to naloxone. Four, to increase awareness of the overdose epidemic. Five, to reduce the stigma associated with substance abuse disorders. Six, to improve prevention education for all Alabamians. Seven, to enhance the prescription drug monitoring program. Eight, promote evidence-based guidelines for pain management. and last, to improve coordination and collaboration among relevant stakeholders. It's an ambitious mission, but the good thing that we have, although we have a very relatively short time frame, is that there are committees that have already been working as a result of the group of the other council to begin talking about issues and ideas going forward. And what we want to be able to do is to give those committees an opportunity to make a report today. To the extent they're prepared to talk a little bit about kind of what's been going on with them and what they've done. To the extent that you don't want to make a report today, that's fine, although with the next meeting, we're really asking you to be able to do that. What I'm going to do is identify our committees, and if you're here and want to make a report, if you want to be able to come forward. First of all, this is the data committee. Are they prepared to make reports?
Working community, and I see a handful of our committee members out there, and I would like to ask you to stand. We have met, thank you very much, guys. We have met on numerous occasions, and it's been a gnashing of teeth, but we have finally come up with some recommendations for the council. But I have before you a subcommittee report from the data committee, along with the recommendations that we will be making, and are identified data metrics. So we were charged with identifying data sources and key metrics needed to describe the problem of heroin and opioid use in Alabama and for describing the success of the efforts of the Governor's Council. We completed our task and we've identified the data we feel is needed to identify the problem and measure the success of strategies placed in motion by the Governor's Council. The spreadsheet that is attached to this report that's going around identifies each data we have received in this endeavor. We've identified the agency that will provide the data and the organizations that would use each of the data metrics. The data committee is recommending that a central data repository be established to hold the data and distribute results to identified agencies. After much discussion, we feel that an independent agency is needed to be the data warehouse and not one of the agencies providing or receiving the data metrics. In July, the Alabama Public Health Institute presented to our group. This recently formed agency is an independent 501c3 organization established to develop a statewide collaborative to share data and expertise for the purpose of improving the health of all Alabama residents. This institute will provide objective, comprehensive, and timely data and analysis to guide and inform public policy. And we feel that this is the independent party that we need to help us with this endeavor. So for future directions, recommendations from the data committee are number one. Secure council approval of the identified data metrics needed along with data sharing agreements for all agencies submitting the data or utilizing the data. In the event data sharing agreements cannot be obtained for all sources, the committee recommends legislation requiring submission of identified data elements. Number two, further explore the possibility of working with Alabama Public Health Institute to become the central data repository or data warehouse for data needed to fight the opioid crisis. Number three, develop an opioid dashboard for public access, educating the public and keeping them informed of the problem and the successive efforts to reduce deaths and misuse is critical to this endeavor. And number four, change the current Alabama law governing the dissemination of data of the Alabama PDMP for research, providing more comprehensive and timely data to prescribers, dispensers, public health officials, treatment and prevention providers, law enforcement. For our independent public health institute will help Alabama quickly recognize trends and disparities, direct aid resources rapidly, and better focus our prevention efforts. The spreadsheet that you have is condensed because the one that we have is about this long. We need to identify all kinds of data elements, the pieces of data that are needed, what it's going to give us. But this, I just go over and walk through it briefly with you. Our number one is we want to know how many deaths are occurring. And the agencies that would be providing this data is the Alabama Department of Public Health. We have just in Jefferson County Medical Examiner because in Jefferson County, They have to. They are there in this state and has done a very, very good job of gathering data. Is this MPDMP? No, it's not. What we are looking for here, we want to find the counties with the high growth beds. And the organizations that said that they would use this measure are identified below. And going down through all of this, I won't go through each of them because we don't have that kind of time. But I ask you to take this with you, look at it. If you have any questions, feel free to give me a call. Is there any questions? Thank you.
One thing that I would encourage the feedback for the committee is to be able to do that spreadsheet. Partly, I can look at Brady House, for example, and see whether or not AOC can identify specifically what's there. I know that they're requesting heroin in case of some of the drug court, for example. I'm not sure we're capturing that data right now, but it may be part of what the data committee needs is some feedback from you to see whether or not, although it's valuable data, whether or not, number one, we can do it now, but also whether or not it's possible for us to modify how we're obtaining data for the future. So I think it would be helpful. And by the way, did everybody get a copy of the handout? Or got that? We may circulate that again as well electronically. But one thing, and Diane, would you be the one to be able to leave the person for the feedback for the community on that? Y'all got her email address in your hand. So if you can respond to her, if you see an area that is of interest to you or in an area that you are responsible for or connected to, about whether or not data can be collected, and if so, how it's collected to be able to be used. All right, thank you for that. Next, anybody here for treatment and recovery?
Good afternoon. I'm Sarah Harkless, and I'm not silent at all, partner to Diane Boyer. The Treatment and Recovery Support Committee met last on May 16th. And we have our mission is to expand the quality and availability of evidence-based treatment for substance use disorders in Alabama, which seems like a pretty good task, a pretty simple task. Most people think of treatment in terms of beds. And think, when you think treatment, all we need is provisions and all of that. When in reality, it's really a lot more complicated than that. There are a lot of factors that we have to consider in terms of fulfilling our mission. Things like elderly treatment, gender, and there is a big, huge uptake of opioids by people in the elderly category today. Gender issues, women have special needs, veterans, criminal justice population, social determinants of health, level of care. There are many levels of care for substance abuse treatment other than just residential treatment. Funding, evidence-based practice, stigma, parity, and education. Too many people in the state don't know how to access treatment. So what we have done is that we have come up with 16 strategies that we feel will help us to fulfill our mission. The first one is engaging hospitals in cost-saving strategies. Number two is promoting ESPR, screening, pre-intervention, and referral to treatment, which is an effective way of intervening on people who have substance use disorders, opioid use disorders, before they get to the point that they require high levels of treatment costing a lot of money. The third one is implementing the chronic disease model of addiction. Too many people don't think of addiction, opioid addiction, or any addiction as a disease. And when they think of it, they think of it in short-term care. Go to the treatment center, get 28 days, come out, and you're cured. And it really doesn't work like that. The fourth one is full implementation of the 2008 Parity Act, which would put the treatment of opioid addiction and other addictions on the same level as any other healthcare problem in the nation. And that has not been fully implemented in the state of Alabama. Number five, broader CPT coverage of addiction. Number six, increase the treatment system's capacity. And we know that we do not have enough treatment in all of Alabama to meet all of the different needs of all of the different populations that we need to serve. Number seven, increase funding for the treatment and recovery support services system. Number eight, increase visibility of the system. Number nine, encourage more physicians to obtain data waivers, which is a waiver where a physician can prescribe drugs for the treatment of opioid addiction without having to operate a full-blown medication-assisted treatment program. Number 10 is develop minimal standards for data waiver physicians. Number 11, work with state boards to encourage mid-level practitioners to become buprenorphine prescribers. Number 12, examination of the private community corrections treatment impact, and that is the impact on people getting into treatment through the criminal justice system. We know that we have some judges and criminal justice practitioners who are referring people to specific treatment, which may or may not be the type of treatment that they need, and also some dictating that they cannot have certain types of treatment. And we need to examine that. Number 13, we need to increase alternative settings and access for substance use disorders treatment, especially primary care access. Number 14, bolster the substance use disorders workforce. Number 15, bolster support for families. And number 16 is promote standards of excellence. And there is science behind addiction treatment now. We know what works and what does not work, and we want to promote that. What we have done is we have collapsed those 16 strategies into six work groups. And those work groups are to develop related strategies, related goals, objectives, and tasks for the council's strategic plan around the area of treatment and recovery support services. And we will have what we're going to do, our next steps. While we are working in these committees, we're going to review other state strategic plans, and there are many. We can provide you, our office can provide you with some if you need more than what has been provided at today's meeting. Many states have already tackled this problem. We're going to also examine the Surgeon General's report on addiction in America. And we're going to also look at the National Governors Association publication on state strategies for dealing with the opioid epidemic and come up with our goals and objectives and strategies. Our next meeting is scheduled for September 19th at the University of Alabama in Tuscaloosa, and we will have at our next meeting a more detailed report of what we've identified. Thank you.
Thank you for that. 15 minutes. Good job. Law enforcement, you can hear your report on that.
The law enforcement subcommittee has not met since the council last meeting in May, where it was. We provided our committee report during that meeting. We had five recommendations. I don't think those recommendations were changing of what I was doing. We'll reconvene the committee, law enforcement subcommittee this month. We'll go over those and we'll be prepared to release those in the next meeting.
Thank you. would ask that that law enforcement committee look at two things as well, one of which is that you don't have the ability to do sophisticated trafficking investigations using wiretap in Alabama for drug investigation, like for Barry, you and I, we'll talk about that more in Brian. We'll see about being able to do that going forward. And then, Representative Weaver had a very good bill with that law, and I hope that we will continue to be able to pursue. All right, prescriber dispensary committee. Hey everybody, I'm Jeff McClendon. We finalized our report to the committee. I know it was on April the 19th. Our recommendations went in. We did have a good group. We met several times, calling on others to come provide us some input. I'm just going to go down the list. It's almost a bullet point. Things that we were interested in. One of the things providers, we got a lot of feedback on the BDMP. There is a lag time with the BDMP. Physicians find that rather frustrating to access that. Prior to prescribing, but we felt strongly that accessing the PDMP prior to prescribing opioids or narcotics of any sort should be a part of this. This is the way that we know that they're not stacking them up and loading up with them. Not only should prescribers, but also dispensers need to enter the data the same day in a timely manner. I talked to pharmacists where maybe once a week they would catch up with entering the data. We also found times where a tech would enter the data and if they did a previous entry on that particular patient, they didn't necessarily check to see if it was a different prescriber. They just okayed it again, which gives us opportunity for some problems. The request was also made by providers, physicians, that the PDMP information be a part of the patient's medical records, which would make it much easier than to glance into that record rather than sit down and designate someone to sit down at the computer to look up the information. And it was the feeling of our committee that there's going to be resistance to mandatory usage of the PDMP unless there's some improvement in the software, the speed and efficiency of the software. That is going on. That's not being ignored. I haven't talked to anyone recently about it. We'll see, but I think that's going to be essential that be done in real time. Now, an interesting use of the PDMP data would be informing prescribers. Where are you ranked in the state as far as prescribing? And also, more importantly, where are you ranked as a prescriber within your peer group? Certain specialties are going to use narcotics and opioids more than others. And it would be good feedback for the prescribers to be able to see where they stand compared to the other providers in Alabama and within their own specialty. These reports need to later be used to see if the usage rate or prescriber goes up or down. Prescriber might realize that he's near the top of the list for his specialty and he may change his ways. And if you have this accurate information, he can get feedback, he or she can get feedback. One of the issues we ran into with pain clinics is out-of-state ownership, which makes it very difficult for law enforcement here in Alabama to crack down on that. And we even mentioned considering legislation that require pain clinics to be an Alabama, be registered or to an Alabama resident or affiliated hospital or physician license here in the state of Alabama, so we might have some authority over them. Fort Pharmacy also volunteered that this is can be an issue with pharmacies as well. It turns out if it's
hometown mom and pop promised this year to get paid back someone pretty quick, but that's why we're big corporate businesses. There's additional red tape to go through to get information, particularly on a patient. You end up having to send a query to the corporate office somewhere. That would be an interesting one to tackle. You did learn, pretty interesting, the pharmacists know who abusive prescribers are. They see traffic, they see folks. However, what is a pharmacist to them? They don't have a good clear-cut safe mechanism for employee, the last thing a pharmacist needs to do is create a problem for someone sending him and his patients. And pharmacy has talked to me about having a way to work around this issue. And the pharmacists know what's going on, particularly in the small towns. Another interesting source of information would be drug courts. And we have some counties with some extremely effective, I'm proud to say, my home county, Plantar County, has, I believe, I related believe it's a very effective drug court. I have another county close by where they say they're not in the babysitting business. The universal drug courts that would meet a good standard would be definitely helpful in this effort. We did cover insurance, in fact, we invited the representative from Blue Cross, who's here on this today, to tell us about the way insurance deals with opioids and other narcotics, how they pay for them. And we do have some trips in there, you're not going to pay for so much. Well, so what does this mean? This means that cash transactions are automatically red flag. Pharmacists will have someone come in and say, you want to use your insurance? I'm going to open all. I don't want to use my insurance. I'm going to pay cash for this. That's a red flag right there automatically. We discussed, and other states do this, and I believe Medicaid does this here in Alabama, is having designated prescribers and designated dispensers. Put some restriction on where that patient can go and who that patient can get prescriptions from. Once again, that's most likely to be dealt with through a third-party pay, which could be Medicaid or the cross, the cash pay, I'm not too sure how that works. I will say this. First step in legally prescribed drugs becoming illegally diverted drugs is the prescriber. We can't forget that. That's very important. And in March of 2017, the Board of Medical Examiner guidelines, purpose of guidelines, talked to one of my physicians at home, a general practice physician, family practice guy. He was glad to see it because he knew they're on the lookout for people that are over BMEs and on the lookout for people that are over prescribing. He didn't know what over prescribing was. How is it relative? The BME came out with guidelines that they put out, and it's what would be an accepted practice, and what's within the guidelines. So they have told these providers and prescribers, here are the guidelines, here's what to look at. If you're outside of this, you need to look at what you're doing. And we should see, as a result of that, I would think, we're going to see a reduction in some of these prescriptions. One of the things that's happened is we've armed that provider to tell the patient, I can't do that, rather than not resist the patient. Sometimes it's really hard to resist the patient. So I'm really looking forward. That came out in March, April, maybe June. We don't have 6 months of that yet, but I think that's going to be informative when we start seeing the results. Okay, that's all I got. Thank you.
Well, I think you'll be informed here in a few minutes when you get to see some data that may reflect some of that state matter. A rescue committee?
Do we have any members of the Rescue and Recovery Committee here? I think Bob's going to stand here.
Well, we've had a number of different meetings and have kind of looked at what we can do and what strategies that might be employed to expand the access to naloxone. For those of you that were around at the time that we worked on this bill, previously, Good Samaritan law had to be changed, and I want to thank Representative Weaver for working with us to expand the Good Samaritan law to allow for prescribing of naloxone. And right after that, just to give you a quick anecdote, we put together at UAB, Dr. Karen Propsky and I, a crowdfunding effort because there was no money for naloxone. We raised about $12,000 to buy naloxone and to distribute it in the context of a research project so that we tracked out for the 250 or 300 people that we've got right now that we've distributed naloxone to. And the number of, we had 30 overdose reversals that came out of that particular effort. None of that would have happened if we hadn't been able to have a law that allowed us to distribute the naloxone. One of the stories that I'm just going to tell real quickly about that was that we did a lot of work trying to figure out where we could find people where naloxone distribution would be the most effective. And I think that's one of the challenges for our committee right now is trying to give a limited number of naloxone doses that are available for funding for naloxone, putting naloxone in the right places for the right people to have the greatest effect. One of the doses of naloxone that we distributed to was at a treatment center fellowship house. The individual that we distributed the naloxone to was doing really well. He had a furlough for a weekend, so he left on furlough, and then what he hooked up with his girlfriend, and they were in a motel out in Forestville, and they came out of the motel, and there was a guy lying between two cars, and they called police officer showed up, called 911, and he didn't have any naloxone. And then they went back and got the kit that we had distributed to him and brought it out and saved the guy's life. So there was one person with a substance abuse disorder saved him another. Some of the things that our committee has looked at that are basically ideas that we'd like for the larger group to consider is to explore some opportunities to strengthen expand Good Samaritan law. We would like to see maybe increasing the immunity for arrest or prosecution for 911 callers and to take a look at being able to do that. Currently, immunity is only extended to underage alcohol, breaking possession, and misdemeanor control of substance offenses. It's really important that many people overdose. And they're usually a lot, often they're using in groups, someone else, but often when they're by themselves. And part of that is feeling free to call the 911 and to feeling free to use the law. So we'd like to explore expanding this American law. Another thing that we'd like to consider is to broaden the category of people who may conduct training and distribution of naloxone. There are current restrictions on that that easily be safely and appropriately expanded. We'd like to, another idea we've got is to increase access through pharmacies, expanding awareness and use of the existing standard order that they have from the state health office. We recommend considering requiring signage in pharmacies and making the public more aware of naloxone availability. What we'd really like to know is how many pharmacies are out there that actually have naloxone at that available where you can go in with a prescription. We currently have a small group of medical students at UAB that are doing a little study on calling pharmacies and whatever to find and figure out how readily available it is if you walk in and try to buy, because we know from referrals that, that we make from our treatment center or whatever, that a family member will say, I'm going to get a Loxone kit, and then they call back and say, well, I went to my drugstore and they said they could make it available. So we'd like a better feeling about that. And we'd like to incorporate another recommendation is to incorporate written education about the state naloxone policy and standing orders in the state school of pharmacy, so that pharmacies that are coming out understand what the provisions are in terms of naloxone. Our third idea was to increase access to naloxone by first responders, including law enforcement personnel. What we found in pursuing that or looking at that is that a lot of law enforcement officers are amenable to carrying naloxone, but there are two barriers. One is cost, and the other is using the injectable naloxone. But with the broader availability of different methods of administration, we feel like that would be, that's something that could be done. One of the things that we found in doing some survey work on this was that there are a lot of law enforcement agencies that are in large metropolitan areas and say, they would say, you know, EMS gets there just as quick as we could. They're right behind us. We don't need to carry it. But we're very concerned with conversations we've had in rural areas where a police officer may arrive there and they're waiting on an ambulance driver. And so we'd like to make it more available for law enforcement. Our fourth strategy was to create a statewide uniform training and certification program for police and other first responders on the naloxone use, and to deliver that to academy and in-service training for law enforcement officers that want to have it. Our strategy number five was to encourage naloxone prescribing and dispensing as a standard order for all overdose cases treated in hospital emergency rooms. Our survey work and looking at that is a lot of people come to emergency rooms with overdoses and whatever, but as soon as they're medically stable, they're discharged, and it's not a routine practice to either prescribe or offer naloxone. That's something that we feel like really help. Number six was to increase naloxone access to substance use treatment programs, treatment courts, probation and parole, community corrections, neighborhood boarding centers, jail support groups, and other social service agencies. Number seven, use existing resources and identify new funding sources to eliminate the financial barriers to naloxone use. Cost of naloxone, the policies have become so much more expensive over the last few years. It's a real barrier to buying and distributing naloxone. And, you know, unless there's a lot of it out there and it's available, it doesn't have the impact that it can have in terms of reducing overdose deaths. So happy to hear that there's some efforts going in this direction, explore group purchasing and other leverage strategies to expand purchasing options for naloxone. Number nine, encourage routine naloxone prescribing as a co-prescription by physicians who are prescribing high-dose opioids or prescribing opioids and benzodiazepines. Because in so many cases of overdose, benzodiazepines coupled with opioids what's put people into an overdose situation. But we feel like that if we could ask the Board of Medical Examiners to address this in the current guidelines of risk and use mitigation strategies, there's an opportunity there to do some good. Two more. One is develop targeted outreach strategies to reach populations at high risk overdose. People living in jails, residential treatment programs, hospitals, and detox facilities. Develop targeted public health strategies, including targeted legal exchange programs for areas deemed to be high risk of opioid-related health and epidemics. We've got some counties in this state and some areas where HIV and other types of waterborne illnesses have just mushroomed with huge costs for hospitals and people that are treating these folks. This would be the legislation, the 27th House Bill 455, the Injection Associated Infectious Disease Elimination Act. We'd like to hopefully have that reintroduced this year, maybe get passed. And number 13, emphasize rescue breathing and CPR as part of educational and training recommendations for overdose response. Number 14 is increase general public awareness of naloxone, its availability, its effectiveness. We would like to figure out a way for a low cost grassroots or social media kind of campaign strategy to get the word out about naloxone availability. Officer, thank you. By the way, Officer, maybe you want to talk to the gentleman who made that call me here today, you know, that I like to do. Yeah, we will take a break right after this, and then we'll get into the other reports after that.
So I'm all the same in between us and breaks, so I'll make this quick. We last met on July 27th at the University of Alabama. We believe that prevention and education and media really has overlap with every single other committee, because that's the messaging that we have to develop. It has to be very nuanced. It has to be very data-driven. We met at UA to go meet with their collegiate recovery program. They have one of the best programs in the country. We wanted to try to get some best practices from them. We went and talked to both the students that are involved in that program and kind of just gathered information, the administrators and everyone involved with that, because we think the messaging we're going to have to develop needs to be different based on the end consumer. What we tell the 50-year-old mother of two of Vestavia Hills is different than what we need to tell the 22-year-old in active addiction in Muscle Shoals. So that was part of that effort, was our last meeting. I'll provide a written report soon. I would say, too, that as a state, I feel like we really need to rethink our entire approach. For the longest time, we've spent all this time and effort and energy taking drug addicts and throwing them in jail. And then they get out, and then we throw them in jail again. When they get out of the front of the jail, we're kind of like the guy who goes to the beach Monday to get sunburned, then he goes to the beach Tuesday to get sunburned, he goes to the beach Wednesday to get sunburned. So Thursday morning he wakes up and goes down to CVS and buys aloe. He doesn't buy sunscreen. We have to start investing some money in prevention and building bigger prisons. It's been eye-opening for us and our committee this week. Probably just stays and talk to all sorts of people involved in this particular right now. So I would also advise this. I think when you were talking about the opioid, the public warehouse, so to speak, where the public can go, we discussed the same thing. So I think it would be good if all of the committee chairs had much of the time soon and just sort of discuss where there's overlap and where we can kind of avoid duplication and get a little bit better communication role than we get.
All right, on my watch, I have 2:27. Let's start back at 2:45. And all the committee chairs, if they want to come forward just real quick before the break, otherwise, I'll see you all back in 15 minutes.
One of the things that I thought would be important for us would be able to get some up-to-date data today to help us understand a little bit about what we're seeing in the trends related to prescription opioids, but also for our medical providers in the day-to-day, you take a lot better than Blue Cross to be able to help share that information. Dr. Smith is going to be able to give us, I think, some really telling data. I was very interested in what she was writing early on, and I think you will find it
very interesting and compelling as well. Thanks, man.
Thank you. And I really appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to you guys here today. This is an impressive room full of folks. Walked in and realized I would be speaking to you guys. I got a little bit nervous there. But I wanted to talk a little bit today about what we see from the impact on healthcare costs from opioid misuse and abuse. And I know we hear the word epidemic a lot these days, and we hear crisis, and now we hear national emergency when we talk about opioid misuse and abuse. And I wonder sometimes when I'm out speaking, if we've saturated the airwaves, if we've inundated people with this information, we've kind of made them tune out. But then I hear stories like Josh's story from earlier, when he's speaking to kids about prescription opioid misuse. And that's the topic that their parents don't cover. And then I was here in Montgomery a few weeks ago, I was waiting to do a discussion on the new news program. I was in the green room with some other folks who were there to promote their events. And when I gave them, you know, the reason why I was there, they looked at me and they said, do you really think that's a problem in Alabama? And so when I hear things like that, I realize that maybe we haven't saturated the airwaves, and maybe we just haven't put the right message out there. I think Josh also mentioned we really need to kind of target our message as well. So also saw some information this weekend that I was just going to share really quickly. It's preliminary information from the CDC from 2016 overdoses from all overdoses increased 22% from 2015 to 2016. Overdoses of fentanyl and fentanyl-like synthetic opioids more than doubled in that time period. There were 20,100 overdoses from fentanyl, preliminary data from 2016. So when I hear things like that too, I realize that we still have a lot of work to do. So I want to share with you, first off, some data that we see. So level set, I'm going to share data from our in-state underwritten population. So these will be our individual members on and off exchange. There are small group or Marin underwritten groups, and the Blue Advantage, our Medicare Advantage product. I'm not including any self-funded data here. So when we look at those parameters, we have about 717,000 members in the denominator. And of that 717,000, 53,000 met criteria for what we consider chronic opioid use. And that's four or more opioid prescriptions that are filled in a 12-month period by a member who doesn't have a cancer diagnosis. And the 12-month period that we're looking at here ended April 30th of 2017. That's the most up-to-date data that we have. So it's pretty recent. These 53,000 members are about 7.5% of that 717,000 population. And they account for over 25% of the medical costs for that population. And that cost includes the cost of the opioid medication itself, which is a little over $31 million for that in-state population. So what I think is the most important aspect of this is that 93% of that, or $29.1 million, is spent by members who are using opioids chronically. So when you think about all the opioid prescriptions that are written in this state, the prescriptions for tube extractions, for fractures after a fall, motor vehicle accidents, joint replacement surgeries, all those acute-type prescriptions, still, one in four of every prescription that's filled in Alabama is filled by a member who's using opioids on a chronic basis. But the real cost that we see is not the medication itself. $31 million is a lot of money. But what we see in members who use opioids chronically is that they use all healthcare services across the spectrum at much higher rates than those members who don't feel chronic opioids. They use more x-rays, more lab services, ancillary services, they have more hospital visits, they have more procedures, and as we'll look at here, they have a lot more emergency department visits and inpatient admissions. So when we look at emergency department visits, every year about 12% of our typical in-state population will have an ED visit. When we look at members who use chronic opioids, almost three times as many will go to the emergency room. So almost a third of those members will have an ED visit in a 12-month period. And when we look at inpatient admissions, the numbers are even more staggering. About 3% of our population in a typical year will have an inpatient admission. When we look at chronic opioid users, almost six times as many have an inpatient admission. So when we talk about cost, the medication itself is obviously just a small part of that. But I think it's important also, as somebody mentioned earlier, the risk of combinations of opioids and benzodiazepine medications. And that is critical. A third of opioid overdoses in the U.S. involve this specific combination. Almost a year ago, the FDA required a black box warning on both of these classes of medications, warning of the risk of respiratory depression, coma, and death with this combination. And when we look at our members that are prescribed dealing chronic opioids, about 40% of those are also dealing chronic benzodiazepines using that same definition. We know that's a deadly combination. And these members who are filling this combination see an average of 3.4 different prescribers who are each writing a controlled substance prescription for them. So you see the cost of opioid medication is $29 million a year in this population. Then when we look at the increased cost of our other services across the board, we saw six times hospital admissions, three times emergency department visits, increased uses of labs, ancillary services, x-rays, procedures. Actually calculating the true cost of opioid misuse and abuse is almost impossible. But I'm not going to leave you with that depressing information. I actually have a little bit of good news. I want to share some data that we've been calculating on opioid prescriptions that we've seen. So these are opioid scripts per 1,000 for our book of business. And you can see about 2 years ago, this is April of 2015 through April of 2017. These data points are rolling 12-month averages. So for the 12 months ending April of 2015, we had about 904 opioid prescriptions per 1,000. So almost one per member. But if you look at April of this year, you can see that we're down to just over 800. So we've seen about a 10% decrease in total opioid scripts per 1,000. So we get the CDC information, we get a lot of bad news, and Alabama remains at the top of opioid prescribing. But I do want to share with you that I think the impacts of, you know, masses, prescriber education, the Board of Medical Examiners, intervention, some interventions that we've put in place really are making a difference and prescribing patterns in the state. We can break this down by long-acting and short-acting opioids. Long-acting opioids are ones that you would expect members who have a chronic pain diagnosis to be on a continual, regular basis. So you'd want to see these to be about a 30-day prescription each, and that's what we're seeing. The average day supply here is right at 29 days. We've also seen some decrease from about 55 scripts per 1,000 down to a little under 51 now. We're making an impact there. We're also making an impact on short-acting prescriptions. So these are your Norco generic, hydrocodone generic, oxycodone prescriptions that you might get after a surgery, an accident, a dental visit. So you can see a couple of years ago, we were at 850 scripts per 1,000, and we're down to 760 right now. So again, a little over a 10% decrease in that. I did want to share some good news with you about prescribing patterns. We also have some information on Suboxone prescriptions. So this is a medication-assisted treatment. And we've really climbed from August of 2015 and kind of leveled off starting about mid-2016. It's almost 37 scripts per 1,000. And rolling 12-month period, we kind of maintain that. The good news about this, too, is that the average day supply for these Suboxone prescriptions is 25 days, so members are getting about a month's worth at a time. And the average number filled per 12-month period is about 8. Now, ideally, we want 12-30-day prescriptions per 12-month period. But when you look at the number of members who might fill one or two prescriptions and then stop, having 8 prescriptions per 12-month period is still a pretty good result. So it's better that we've been seeing. That's improving as well. And so I finally want to close out with some data from the Blue Cross Association's Health of America report on opioid use. They looked at national data from their Blue Cross plans across the country to see what the trends are and then how different states compare in their commercially insured population. So I'm going to share a little bit of that with you. When you look at members who filled one or more opioid prescription in 2015, nationally, that number was 21% in the Blue Cross Association's membership. Vermont was the lowest at 14%. You can see we're at 26%. We were right even with Arkansas for number one on that. They were at 27%. So again, we don't want to get complacent with our percentages per thousand decreasing. We've got some work to do when you look at number of prescription members who filled a prescription. And also when we look at members who are on a long duration opioid regimen, and the association used 90 days or more as their definition of long duration. And we were actually the highest for this particular data point. 6.5% of commercially insured Blue Cross members who live in Alabama were on a long duration opioid regimen. In 2016, the national average was 3.8%. Minnesota was the lowest, you can see. Tennessee was second to us, and they were at 5.5%. So there's a little bit of space between us and number two there. When you look at members who had an opioid use disorder diagnosis that was made in calendar year 2015, these are numbers per thousand, not percentages. So the Blue Cross average was 8.3 per thousand. We were at 16.4 per thousand. We were right behind Tennessee at 16.5. I will say that this isn't necessarily as negative a fact as I think it could be, because it means that we're at least recognizing opioid use disorder now. We're diagnosing it, and that's the first step toward treatment. So the fact that we do have these diagnoses, I think, can in some way be seen as a positive as long as we see those trends start to go down. I know you talked about treatment for opioid use disorder. These are members with an OUD diagnosis who received medication-assisted treatment in 2016. We're not doing so well here. We're below the average again, which is 37%. We're at 29%, but we're not the lowest. Georgia was at 25%. And I don't know what they're doing here in Vermont, but they have an amazingly high MAT treatment rate at 87%. So I think that's something that we can definitely consider here in this room, and then also at Blue Cross Blue Shield of Alabama. We'll have a call to Vermont to kind of see, you know, what they're doing there with MAT. So obviously, you've heard the statistics, and we've heard reports from our committee members. Obviously, this is a problem that's beyond any one group, organization, entity. But we do support treatment for substance use disorder in a 12-month period that ended October of 2016. ANCR spend for inpatient and outpatient substance use disorder treatment. Our buprenorphine prescription spend, that's been pretty steady. We have seen an increase in Vivitrol prescriptions, which is good. That's the long-acting injectable naltrexone treatment. So for the 12-month period that ended in October, that was about $500,000, now it's $682,000. So we are getting more uptake on Vivitrol, which I think is very positive. January 1st of this year, we eliminated the exclusion for methadone medication-assisted treatment. So this is covered now under a member's medical benefit at federally qualified methadone treatment facilities. We've supported the CDC guidelines for appropriate prescribing for chronic pain for primary care providers. We provide education for our in-network physicians at community events and town halls. The partnerships with eDirections, which is our behavioral health partner, which is actually in the building with us. So their medical director and I meet at least monthly to discuss members, especially members who have
the criminal diagnosis of substance use disorder and behavioral health diagnosis. And we're working with Tom Therapies, which is our pharmacy benefit manager, around some other initiatives that we can look at as far as first fills, initial fill clients, those sorts of issues. And then our Blue Cross Association national initiatives include workshops for journalists who are covering the opioid epidemic. They provide some guidelines and information for them. They sponsor drug take back games. This is a PBS documentary that comes out hopefully in a few weeks with us as local sponsors of the association, as national sponsor. And the association is also working with educational organizations and other entities to support research around evidence-based treatment practices. So again, we know this is an epidemic crisis, national emergency, and we're happy to be at the table with all of you guys as we try to come up with a solution.
Questions?
Yes.
I think that was part of it, especially on the short acting opioid trend there. I think we've had some education throughout the state. I think the Board of Medical Examiners and MASA has done a good job about educating our providers. I think also within that time period, we saw some very high volume prescribers who came off the market, so to speak, I guess. They were prosecuted for their prescribing patterns, and I think so they were out of the mix, and then that also had an effect, I think, on some other prescribers who looked at that and, you know, kind of made some different decisions as far as treatment goes there. So I think that was a combination of a lot of those different things. I think hopefully we'll see that trend continue.
Just as a comment, Vermont has a little decrease in the number of overdose deaths that goes with that increase in medical assisted treatment. It's in their numbers. And so they bother to emerge people that are chronic users into treatment for less reduce their overdose deaths. That's important to know. The other question that I had was, does this include Blue Cross dental plans, or it doesn't matter?
This includes, this information is only medical, so members who have our medical coverage. Okay. We didn't do the dental coverage separately. We can certainly do that analysis, and I'd be happy to bring it to one of our future meetings.
The administration of prescriptions is covered by the medical plan.
Correct. So a prescription, that's correct. So that data would be in there.
Is all your medical plans support the medical treatment?
They're all of our underwritten plans do. Group, I didn't include any self-funding group data in this, and so I can't speak directly to, I don't want to misspeak on whether or which groups might exclude that, but all of our underwritten plans do cover medication assisted treatment.
This is a good place for this, secondary costs and primary costs of addiction in general, whether it's opioids or whatever, maybe it permeates everything in our state. I think it would really help for the cost making and the legislative members. We all said it, like I remember, and I don't speak for DHR, but I remember in one of our meetings, Nancy said that when she first started, you know, a parent was addicted, they, you know, they had to take the child and look at who's their mama's house. And a mom and a sister are the same way. So the cost of care budget is good for the intervention fix. Obviously, law enforcement, forensic science, we all know that. For Medicaid, I don't have access to those numbers, but I can see probably if you can check, you know, how the Medicaid, and we all hear about what that does to our budget and everything else. And coming to know where that idea is the rise, and if somebody goes, here's a seizure for going to the ER for the doctor, ER doctors do a deal.
Oh, yeah.
So they turn away or not. They do their job and be diligent and say, well, it might be a good prescription. So I just think it will help every area, not just the traditional thing. We live in addiction, law enforcement,
the workforce is so good. We were just, I was just at a group advisory board meeting of our larger self-funded groups not too long ago, and the topic of opioid misuse and abuse came up. And our groups are having trouble filling their jobs, especially organizations or groups that are in manufacturing and construction type areas. They can't find qualified workers who can pass the drug test. One of our group HR representatives shared that they drug tested 20 potential employees and only one passed.
And one thing that was really happy here in the department and talking is because of representative from hospital college. If you ask someone now, so what's the number one drug that you have? If you see it's still in your studies, in your sports, in your teams, it's ADHD. If you need it, it's a godsend. If you don't need it, it's Steve. And so, you're one of the coaches telling football players that players don't pay attention, they don't hear what you say, you know, and you feel it for it. And that's issue of students. So I think it would be great for us to take what you've done here, which is fantastic, but to overlay that, I think it would be a huge help for our lawmakers to see just what the impact is, not the impact on lives and communities is enough, but see, also seeing that bottom line, I think, would be a huge help. And I think I'd encourage you.
Just before I left my office to try to see this meeting today, I really wanted to make sure that we got facts in the office from the request. The response to the prior authorization that I submitted, the petition that I have on this laptop for the public information. And the letter was informing me that there was no prior authorization necessary for this petition. This is the first time. I mean, I think it was got for 7 years, and we've always had a new prior authorization. This is the first time I have a letter saying that no prior authorization is necessary.
Yes,
of course, I wish I had known that before I sent the letter. Is that something that is...
So we did remove the prior authorization requirement for Suboxone effective July 1st. I believe we'll be back to date. We still do have quantity limits on that. Never really refilled. That would be a major theater problem.
One other presentation, one thing that I'm really excited about is Commissioner Bashir's energy and enthusiasm for this project is through the roof. And one thing that she is bringing to the table is really a community perspective of what we're doing. You heard her announced in the committee, but also understands that the community engagement is vital to this discussion. I think one of the folks that's doing it well, doing it really well, and not only invested people, but also resources in that project is what's going on in Shelby County. So I'll let you know if I'm talking about Compact 2020.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon from Shelby County. Thank you, General Marshall, and thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the council for letting me come out and just talk to you for a little bit about what we're doing in Shelby County. First, I want to say that Jill Lee is absolutely the champion behind this effort in Shelby County. When she first started having conversations with the county commission and the sheriff about what she wanted to do, I'm her chief assistant DA, so I went to her and I told her, Jill, we can't do this. We're barely above the water right now. We can't do this. And Jill, for anybody who knows Jill, very directly looked at me and said, Allie, it's too important not to give it our best shot, and I look forward to seeing how effective you are going to be leading. Here we have our partners that are working alongside of us in Shelby County. We had most of the pieces of this puzzle already in place in Shelby County. We've always had a robust enforcement effort with the Drug Enforcement Task Force. We've had a great drug board for a dozen years. Through the years, we lost our law enforcement personnel who supported that drug board team. They're back on board now as part of Compact 2020. And what we learned from the people in our drug court who suffered with substance use disorder was that this is, in fact, a disease. And based on our conversations with them over time, we realized that this is a disease that is primarily acquired in adolescence. That is the information that is driving our response in Shelby County. Really, the newest part of this is the prevention and intervention piece. So I'm going to spend the rest of my time focusing on that part of the effort. What we have is each one of our municipal partners provides a law enforcement officer. They become a part of our community liaison team. So they continue to go back out in their communities, develop information. They investigate adolescent substance abuse. People freak out when I talk about that. I'll explain that in a little more detail in a second. They do environmental scans of the community. What are the things that are out here that are impacting this problem positively, negatively, and if it's just neutral, and what can we do to remove those factors from risk factors to protective factors for our people? And then communicate. So as part of this, we're also developing local level prevention teams. So in each city within Shelby County, we have people from all walks of life who serve on these local level prevention teams, and our law enforcement officers are delivering information to them in the form of an assessment. We also have a prevention director who works side by side with all these law enforcement officers. So I'm going to take you through what they do, each one of their assignments. Adolescent drug use investigations, this is the part that scares people when I say that. These guys are intentionally going out there investigating adolescent substance abuse. And people say, well, here they go again, they're trying to drag everybody in the court, everybody in the system. That is not what we're doing. What we are doing is we're gathering as much information as we possibly can. This is an incredibly difficult population to release. We don't have informants for this. We don't have undercover cops for this. So we're using all the resources at our disposal to develop information, and instead of waiting to catch one of these kids holding, I pick up the phone and I call parents. Once we reach a certain level, we pick up the phone, we call the parents, we ask to have a meeting with them. We tell them what we got. Your son has been communicating with a drug dealer. No, not my son, can't be. He's threatening his drug dependence. It's your kid. Here's text communication from your child and drug dealer. The task force guide 2 weeks ago. And what we have to be careful about is remembering that we can't help them. We notify them. That's our responsibility. We notify them. And then at that point, we extend ourselves as a resource if we can. Sometimes sitting down, if we catch them early enough, sitting down across the table from a law enforcement officer might be all it takes, that brush from law enforcement. But we try to connect them to people who we know can address the problem that they have. So we try to get them connected to treatment. The reason that parent notifications isn't at 118 is because we have a lot of kids that we see, but we don't know who they are yet. We try to use our school resource officer network to get them identified, and as soon as we can get them identified, we sit down with parents. And this is, it's deeper than substance. So you guys know this better than I do, most of you do. But what we see is the trauma that comes along with the development of the disease. This young man hit our radar on a Friday morning, talking about suicide. We were able to take advantage of our school resource officer network. Who is this? We gotta get in front of this right now. So we have a Hoover officer on our team. We have a Hoover sergeant he works with. Who happens to live in Trustful. We eventually tracked this young man down to Trustful High School. Using that network, we're able to get his counselors informed so they can get in front of that problem. Smartphones are setting this, it's like dumping gasoline on fire. We had a problem with adolescents already. These smartphones, if I had had unfettered access to a smartphone when I was 15 years old, more than likely, I would not be working in the DA's office today. Lord knows I got in enough trouble as it was. But parents have no idea the destructive power of those phones. Our investigations are also showing us the trauma that underlies some of the substance abuse. And what happens when kids are trying to support their habit. We've run into young men selling themselves on Craigslist. I'm talking about high school kids. They put themselves out there as 18-year-olds. And folks in our communities
just aren't aware of all the horrible, horrible problems that flow from substance use. I want to talk a little bit about the environmental scans that our law enforcement officers do. And again, I ask them to go out and see everything in the community, look at it. Is this positive, negative, or is it neutral? And then what can we do about it? So I'm going to pick on Chelsea. I live in the city of Chelsea. This is up on the corner of Highway 280 and County Road 47. If you drive down to Auburn Gate, you may go that way. This Tiana, Barry, I think what I've been told is that this was the industry's response to the crane wall, right? You've got Legal Lane over here. All this stuff is right at the point of purchase. Right, so this is having a really problematic impact on people who are trying to live a recovery lifestyle. So they're in our truck court, they go to get gas, they go to get a diet out of the zoo, they're checking out, and all this stuff is in their face, and they think to themselves, well, this is legal, so I can use it. And they probably won't pay me to use it, at least for some time. This is the cocoa snuff that was also in that picture that you just saw. And it talks about, it brags about that it can create a morphine-like effect. This is one of my favorite pictures right here. This is in the chips aisle. Okay, so you walk in, you turn right, you go get a bag of chips. I walked by this glass case 100 times before I saw this. So you got all these pipes that are out there, which is not paraphernalia, so it's been used improperly. They're selling these pipes here clearly to consume marijuana or some other substance. And down on the bottom of the glass case, there is synthetic urine for sale. Alright? So I'm in there taking these pictures, get downloaded and take a picture of the synthetic urine that's obviously, you know, being used to try to get through a drug test. The guy comes out behind the counter and says, hey, is there anything wrong with it? No, I'm in the DA's office, it's fine. You got nothing to worry about. As far as I know, everything you're doing here is legal. But you should know that I'm about to have a meeting with the mayor, PTO president, some church folks, and they're going to ask serious questions about what you're selling in your store. I went back, the urine was gone, the other stuff was there. I'll get back to that. This is what we do with our local prevention teams, with our prevention director, is we walk them through a strategic planning process. So once we've identified all the problems in Shelby County, in that particular city, walked it through a strategic planning process. And as Carol Williams, our prevention director, was trying to explain this to me, I realized that this is really just a very poor planning process, but she's changed the acronyms and made a flower out of it. So she eats her flower, but I'm using the very poor planning process because I can't learn new acronyms at this point in my life. This is the composition of the teams. This is the kind of spread that we want. Very important, in my opinion, that we have support from healthcare, from fire and EMS. I've sat down with our firefighters and I've told them, people are sick of seeing me on TV. They're really sick of seeing Clay on TV, Clay Hannon, our Drug Enforcement Task Force commander. Our voices are falling on deaf ears now, I think. I think if you send a message about how dangerous these substances are, through firefighter, or through, better yet, through a doctor, and you do it consistently, and your message is, this is bad for you, I think people are more willing to listen to that than they were listening to us. This is the meeting in Chelsea. And the interesting thing about this picture is in the back row there, we have a youth pastor, the mayor, and William Wainscott, who actually operates the Suboxone Clinic in Chelsea. Great exchange. Everybody on that back row learned a lot during this process. And I was basically rolling out for them everything that we've seen in our assessment of the city of Chelsea. Of course, there was outrage. But the coolest thing that came out of that, initially when people hear about what's being sold at those convenience stores, they want to look at us and say, well, you guys need to do this, and you guys need to do that, and we need an ordinance, and we need a business license.
I look at them and I say, we've been trying to do this for a long time. We've got to do it. We got to have you. You have to take notice. People are ready to be mobilized on this issue. Let this meeting, within 2 days, it was all gone. All right? Somebody heard the right things in that meeting and just took care of business, and this guy responded. That wasn't a new law barrier. We didn't need new legislation for that. All we had to do to accomplish that in that score was tell people what was going on in their community and invite them to take action. We will guide them. We'll provide tools. We'll provide information. If people are ready to get this done in their own communities, we just got to tell them what's going on. So every week we have a meeting back in our office in Pelham. All the law enforcement officers assigned to those community teams come back and just share their information. So in this picture, we've got all those guys, we've got our prevention director, we've got drug task force. On the conference line in the middle of the table, juvenile probation. So everybody's communicating and everybody's completely aware of what's going on from one end of the county to the other. So if we see a new trend with a drug court participant in Montevallo, it is commuted all the way out to Leeds, Alabaster, Pelham, and every city in between. And finally, we're partnering with our schools. This is something I think is critically, critically important, because everybody's telling us if you're waiting until high school, you're way too late. So this is evidence-based curriculum that we're introducing this year. Incredibly proud of all of our schools for agreeing to do this. The training is next week, and every sixth grader in public school in Shelby County will be receiving this life skills curriculum. It focuses on managing anxiety, exit strategies, don't wait till you're in a situation to figure out how you're going to get out of it. All those things are critically important for kids. Managing technology. It is not a direct substance abuse curriculum. We're really, really excited about it. Prevention Minute, that's a video series that we put out through our Facebook page, and the schools share it through their listserv. So once a month, we have a 1 minute video that goes out to educate parents on what is going on with this particular problem. I have no idea how that slide stayed in there. Guys, thank you for the opportunity. If you do have questions, absolutely, I will stick around and answer any questions you may have. There is a lot going on with this effort, and again, I'm happy to answer the questions you might have.
Have y'all had any assessment yet since you've been around to see what impact it's going to have on the community?
We have not yet gotten to the point where we're able to measure our impact. Basically, what we're tracking right now is the number of parent notifications that we've had. Our graduations from drug court, we continue to track those things. Our private survey results, we expect for there to be an impact with this curriculum rolling out. It's going to be some time before we start to see it. Yes? Well, in the box, there's a plastic tube that holds the synthetic urine, and there are chemical candles. So you have some of these specimen cups that have a temperature strip. So they actually have hand warmers that you can warm it up with and try to feed the temperature strip. And so what they're counting on there is just a urinalysis that is not closely observed. So.
I'm glad you guys have come on board with this,
because
people that are in recovery to
get
y'all and to have
it help
find the children that are using, you know, like, this information.
We are. We take information from any place we can get it. The difficult thing is validating the information that we get. And the rub there is, how long do you have just partial information that you're not really confident you can trust? How long do you wait before you move forward to confident information? I'll be honest with you, I have moved forward with information that, you know, wasn't solid, couldn't validate in any way, shape, or form, but I decided it's just too important, I can't wait, so I pick up the phone and I call, and I'll just try to meet with mom or dad, I'll tell them, hey, look, This may be enough, but this popped up on our radar. I can't validate or verify it anyway whatsoever, but please, if your child's going to a party this weekend, reach out and make a phone call to a parent whose house they're going to. Make sure you know who's there, make sure they know that you're going to follow up and make sure they work this person. But it's a tough call sometimes. Last thing you want to do is wait too long. Here's what we're finding with the parents, and this is sad, is that many, many, many of them already knew that they had the problem, but they didn't know what to do about it. And we were the last people they were going to call. They're afraid of us, guys. They're afraid of what we represent to the future of their children. When they went into the court system, you can talk to them about juvenile court, and there's no record that follows you all day long, they're not going to believe it. So they're thankful. Those parents are relieved, especially when they realize what we want to do is try to get them connected to resources. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely, we will. But I'm super proud of what happened in Chelsea. And the same thing is going to happen throughout the county, I have no doubt. Because, like I said, the people are ready to be mobilized. They've just got to be informed and pointed in the right direction. And that would take a letter at most. But really, someone just let that meeting and report it back to that county and took it out.
Yes, ma'am. I have a question. This is sort of a structure operational. Group of law enforcement officers, are they responsible for going back to their
communities and organizing them? Yes, they are the law enforcement representation for the team.
Mm-hmm.
We kind of become the connective tissue between meetings, so we do a lot of the homework, but what we're finding is over time, those certain people that you really need are stepping up. Right, so you've got the PTO mom who wants to be more engaged in this, you've got the youth pastor who wants to be more engaged in it, and so over time, they will begin to take more on more of a leadership role, and they will become a negative issue in this process.
Okay. But the DA's office is sort of funding you and helping you with it.
It's our county commission. They fund the effort. The money we get from the commission, though, doesn't fund everything, so everybody who contributes a person to this, that's skin in the game. And so let me tell you what Compact 2020 is. Compact is a promise that we have with each other to take care of people in our community. That's the compact. 2020 is 2020. That's our milestone. So we're going to take a look at what we've done, what have we accomplished, what were we able to measure? Are we getting to a point where we're actually starting to see an impact? And if we need to shift directions, where did we go wrong? So that's where we're getting ready. Thank you very much. Thanks.
All right. We're done. What an exciting day. Thank you all for everything you've done to get us to this point, those of you who have been involved. And thank the rest of us for what we're about to do. A couple of housekeeping items. One is, remember the next meeting, it's October 24th at 1 o'clock here. Number two is, if you are not on the committee, we need for you to hang out so that we can get you online. If anyone is interested in chairing and co-chairing the newly created Community Engagement Committee, let me know. Everyone should be inspired by what we just saw with Alan Miller. And number three is, please leave your name tag. And we will get the minutes typed up and out to them. I want to thank again Steve Miller for hosting us here today, and our partner, Dr. Harris. This is an exciting opportunity. We have to have our final report in December, so there's no time to waste. So I'm going to be quiet so that y'all can get back to work.